What's going on, everyone? Gage here from Sharp Knife Shop, and today I'd like to teach you how to sharpen your knife. So the first thing we need to do before we start sharpening is prepare our whetstones. We're going to do this by soaking them in room temperature water for about 10 to 15 minutes or until the bubbling subsides and water pools on top of the stone. You'll notice that as soon as you put your stone into the water, it will start to bubble. This is totally normal and it's just the stone soaking up the water required to stay hydrated during the sharpening process. We're going to move through a progression of three stones today: coarse, medium, and fine. Our coarse stone is going to quickly remove material from our knife and allow us to create a new edge quickly and efficiently. Our medium stone is going to bridge the gap between our coarse and fine stone and allow us to start refining that rough edge that we put on our knife with the coarse stone. Finally, our fine stone is going to polish and further refine the edge of our knife, giving us that silky smooth cutting feel that we're all looking for. Next, we need to find a way to comfortably grip the knife. This is going to be different for everyone, so spend some time finding a grip that works for you. The Japanese like to extend their index finger and place it on the spine of the knife while applying pressure to the heel of the blade with their thumb. I find this grip to be extremely uncomfortable for myself and prefer to keep my index finger wrapped around the handle while still applying pressure to the heel of the knife with my thumb. Our right wrist should stay as locked in place as possible, and our right arm should simply be moving the knife forward and backward across the stone, not applying any pressure. The pressure comes from our left hand, and more specifically our index finger and middle finger, and should apply pressure moving down the length of the blade as we sharpen all the way from the tip down to the heel. Ensure that you're keeping your fingers as close to the edge of the knife as possible where it contacts the stone without actually running your fingers along the stone. As this stone is going to remove steel from our knife, it will most certainly remove skin from your fingers. Now, last but certainly not least, we need to find an appropriate angle to sharpen our knife at. There are a number of different methods to find out what angle to sharpen your knife at, but the one that I've found most effective when teaching my in-store lessons here at Sharp is to imagine that holding the knife straight up and down on the stone is 90 degrees. We can therefore assume that if we cut that in half, we'll get 45 degrees. Cut that in half again and we'll get 22 and a half. Now, this is where you want to sharpen the majority of your run-of-the-mill stainless steels. If you're working with a high carbon steel, you can sharpen a little bit flatter to the stone at around 10 to 15 degrees. The hardness and durability of that steel is going to allow us to sharpen flatter to the stone and allow the knife to hold its edge for a long amount of time without dulling super quickly. A good way to ensure that you're sharpening at an appropriate angle is to set up a camera level with your whetstone and compare yourself with other sharpeners on the internet. As you sharpen more and more and become more proficient, you'll find an angle that works best for you. I found that everyone uses their knife differently and for different things. Thus, the angle at which you want to sharpen your knife is going to be different depending on the person. A good rule of thumb, though, is that sharpening flatter to the stone is going to give you a sharper feeling knife, but one that's edge isn't going to last as long, depending on the steel, of course. And sharpening at a higher angle is going to give you a knife that doesn't feel quite as good, but may have an edge that lasts a little bit longer. Now that all the boring talking is over, we're going to start putting some strokes in on our knife. Now we want to start as close to us as possible on the whetstone, again applying pressure as close to the edge of the knife as possible. On our lower grit stones, we should be applying a good amount of pressure. You should see your fingers changing colors a little bit, turning red or white. Now we want to make long, consistent strokes, applying pressure to the knife as we push it away from ourselves, removing the knife from the stone and coming back to the starting position, moving our fingers slightly down the length of the knife. We're going to continue this process until we've sharpened all the way from the tip of our knife, moving our fingers down the length all the way down to the heel. What we're trying to achieve here is what's called a burr. A burr is a thin thread of steel or scratchy lip of steel that will form on the back side of the blade that you are sharpening. This is the single most important part of sharpening, and if this burr is not formed properly from the tip all the way down to the heel, you will not end up with desirable results. The burr can be a difficult thing to explain, but it should be quite obvious on your low grit stones what it feels like. This burr forms as we remove steel from our knife, and the steel begins to fold over the edge of the knife. With your thumb, feel down the length of the blade. You should feel a scratchy sort of lip on the back side, while the side that you are sharpening should feel smooth and have no scratchiness. I wish I could tell you exactly how long this burr is going to take to form, but since every knife is different, some are duller than others, it's hard for me to say. I will say, however, that if you haven't sharpened your knives in a very long time, this could take upwards of 5 to 10 minutes and even longer in some cases. It's also very important to ensure that we're not flipping sides of the knife before we develop that burr properly all the way from the tip to the heel. Again, if you're switching sides before you develop the burr properly, you're not gonna end up with good results. Once the burr is formed properly all the way from the tip to the heel, it feels even the entire length of the blade, it's time to flip over and do the other side of our knife. Now our grip is going to change slightly when we flip over to do the other side. Our thumb is gonna move from the heel of the knife and now go to the spine. Our index finger is going to apply pressure to the heel of the blade. Our left hand, the thumb is going on the spine of the knife and our fingers are wrapping over top of the blade, again, applying pressure as close to the edge of the knife as possible. Now, instead of starting our stroke closest to us on the stone, we're going to start our stroke furthest away from us on the stone and apply pressure as we pull the blade toward ourselves. Again, we're trying to develop that burr just the same as we did on the front side, using long, consistent strokes using the entirety of the stone. Once again, it's important to ensure that we don't move on to the next step or switch sides of the knife before we form that burr evenly all the way from the tip to the heel. Now that we've formed our burr on the back side of the knife, it's time to move on to the third and final step on this stone, which is to deburr our knife. We're going to achieve this by putting in nice, long strokes all the way from the tip to the heel of the knife, switching sides every time we make a stroke. As we're making these deburring strokes, our hand pressure should lighten up progressively as we go, and to the point where at the very end, we're barely applying any pressure to the knife as we make our strokes. Again, I can't say exactly how many strokes you'll need in order to complete this step, but to ensure you've done a good job, feel both sides of the edge, ensure that there is no burr remaining, run your fingers down the length of the edge, and if it feels like it's grabbing into your skin, you know you've done a good job. We are now going to switch stones from our coarse grit to our medium grit stone and complete this three-step process all over again, forming the burr on the front side of the knife, ensuring that it is even all the way from the tip to the heel, and only then flipping over to do the other side, forming a burr again all the way from the tip to the heel, at which point we're going to complete our deburring process, putting in nice long strokes. At this point, switching the side every time we put in a stroke. Once we have completed this process on our medium grit stone, we're going to move on to our fine grit stone and complete all three steps all over again. In my experience, some people have a hard time identifying the burr on the really high grit stones. If this is the case for you, I would encourage you to do at least 10 passes on each side of the knife, meaning work all the way from the tip to the heel of the knife 10 times before you move on to the next step. Now, as your sharpening improves, I would encourage you to leave your knife in contact with the stone at all times, applying pressure only as you push away from yourself on the front side of the knife, releasing pressure as you return back to the starting position. On the back side of the knife, you're applying pressure as you pull towards yourself and releasing pressure as you return back to your starting position. This is simply to improve your speed and efficiency, but we release pressure on the way back to our starting position to ensure that we don't dig the knife into the stone, ruining all that hard work that we've done. Now that you've moved through all three whetstones, completing each of the three steps on each of the whetstones, how do you know if you've done a good job? Well, a well-sharpened knife will have a distinct edge with a clean, hard line where it begins. Any scratches up the side of the blade means you weren't being consistent, as well as cloudy spots where there isn't a clean, hard line. Of course, there are many ways to test your knife, including the paper cutting test, cutting a tomato, but in my opinion, if you can't shave your arm hairs with your knife, you haven't done a good job. To take your knife sharpness to the next level, consider using a leather strop. The same thing that barbers use to hone their straight razors, a leather strop will further refine the edge of your knife and make it that much sharper. Thank you so much for watching. I really hope this video helped you achieve the sharpening results you are looking for. If you have any questions or comments, or you're confused about any of the process, please leave a comment down below and I will be sure to answer you. We're also going to be giving away all three stones and the Naniwa stone holder that we used in the video today to anyone who likes the video, leaves a comment, and subscribes to our channel. There's also five $20 gift cards that are being given away to anyone who does those three things, so be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks again for watching, everyone, and I hope to see you on the next video.